يا ذا الأسماء الحسنى يا خالقنا غفرانا نسألك وأنت الأسمى نأمل عفوك سبحانك.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So we've gone through some of the names of Allah Azza wa Jal, and we're up to the name Al-Jabbar. So, هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو. Go on. الرحمن الرحيم الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر. So today, inshallah, We'll come on to Jabbar, and hopefully we'll cover his great name Mutakabbir as well. Now, the name Jabbar, it is a name that has occurred in Surah Al-Hashr, and it's also a name that has come in Ahadith. And if you look in Ahadith, you will find it has been used in two ways, one or in the Quran. One is that Allah Azza wa Jalla, He refers to Himself as Al-Jabbar. And in Ahadith or Hadith Qudsi, if Allah Azza wa Jalla is addressing someone and saying, you are Jabbar or something like that, it's in a negative sense. For Allah to be Jabbar, which means mighty, which means powerful, which means one who can coerce others into things, who can make others do things, who can put things right, and so on. There are many meanings we're going to come to. It is positive, which means Allah Azza wa Jalla has the right to do all of these things. But if the son of Adam becomes Jabbar, tries to become mighty, tries to become a tyrant or someone who's trying to exercise his power, then that is negative. That is why in Hadith, in Bayhaqi, is reported that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Inna Allah azza wa jal idha kana yawmul qiyamah." When the day of judgment will actually come, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, jama'a Allahu samawati sab'i wal ardin. Allah will take within his grip, or Allah will put together, He will bring together all the seven heavens and the seven earths, fi qabdatihi, within His power, within His grip, however you want to put it, Allah Azza wa Jalla will bring it together. Then He will say, "An Allah, I am Allah. An Al-Rahman, I am the most merciful. An Al-Malik, I am the King. An Al-Quddus, An Al-Salam, An Al-Mu'min, An Al-Muhaymin, An Al-Aziz. I am Aziz, I am this. And then in the end He will say, "An Al-Jabbar, I am the Mighty One. An al-mutakabbir, I am the one who has the right to show his greatness over others. An al-ladhi badatu dunya, I am the one who has started the creation of this world. Wa lam taku shay'a, when it was nothing. An al-ladhi a'adattuha, I am the one who has prepared all of this. And Ayn al-Muluk, Allah then follows on by saying, Ayn al-Muluk, where are the kings? Ayn al-Jababira, where are those mighty ones? Where are those kings of the world? And where are the mighty ones? The ones who were tyrants, the ones who used to show their might over others, who used to coerce others to do things and so on. Where are they? So this hadith clearly shows that if it's used in the sense where Allah uses for Himself, it is positive, and if He uses it for any of His servants, then it is negative, meaning that He is not pleased with the fact that someone is Jabbar or someone is trying to show his might. In the Quran, Surah Al-Shu'ara, 26th Surah, verse number 130, Allah says, وَإِذَا بَطَشْتُمْ جَبَّارِينَ. Now this is about the people of Ad, the giants. And Sayyiduna Hud alayhi salam is giving them da'wah, and he's telling them to be humble, and he's saying that when you actually traverse the earth and when you actually go to others, then and you try and try and get hold of them, you take hold of them with great might and power, in the sense that you kill them. Because these were giants, and that's how they used to be, that others who were smaller than them, or others who were of their own size, which they had a fight with, an argument with, it would just end up in killing and in murder. So again, the word Jabbarin has been used in this ayah. Now, in Arabic, you have also, with this root letters of Jabbar, which is Jim, Ba, Ra, you have the meaning of making two things that are broken be mended, and for them to be, for you to be the mender and for it to be mended. So for example, if you find something like a bone and you're able to put the two bones together and mend it as one piece, then you have just put it together and it has mended. This, obviously, Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who is Jabbar, in the sense that He can mend things. This can also be a meaning that Jabbar can hold, which is He is the mender, or the one that puts right things that are broken. Okay? And this type of meaning can be used for others as well, but mainly it will be used for Allah Azza wa Jal. And there is a poet who says, قَدْ جَبَرَ الدِّينَ الْإِلَهُ فَجَبَرَ. Allah is the one who will mend the religion when it's broken, and therefore the religion will be in one piece again. This is Allah's way of doing things, and it has his quality of being able to do things that others are not able to do. Now, this thing of mending the religion, what does it mean? It means that he gives it extra might. He's the one that gives the religion an extra might. He will give it an extra support. He will make his religion become dominant over other religions. And therefore, he has given a strength to his religion on the earth that it never had before. This is one of the meanings of Jabbar. This is one of the meanings of Jabbar. Jabiruddin or Jabbaruddin, he's the one that can bring a power, give a power and a might and a strength to the deen, to the religion, which it never had before. Now, when it's used for a human being, what it means that the human being has gone past the limits of Allah. He has gone beyond the boundaries of Allah. He has become strong, stern, stubborn, or someone who is now committing injustice. Committing injustice. So this normally happens either by kings who think that, you know, they're on top of everything, no one is above them, or it can be with anyone who believes that the truth is you know, the truth is beyond them, or that they're above the truth. They're above the truth, they don't need the truth. Either because Allah Azza wa Jalla has given them a whole amount of reason for them to believe that they are proud, and they can have this attitude with others. For example, when Allah gives people a lot of money, it can sometimes turn a person into a jabbar, into a tyrant person. When Allah gives a person some dignity that they found when they were born, like, you know, they were born as a prince, or they were born into a royal family, or they were born into a very important family, or one that has great honor, it can turn certain individuals amongst them to become tyrants. Now, it doesn't have to be, but it's that person who has chosen to be like that. So what they do is they will defy the truth. When the truth comes, they will sort of snort at it and think, well, you know, I don't have to accept that. I don't have to do that. So they will then cross the boundaries of Allah and start to commit dhulm, which is oppression. And this is something which we have seen. And they will not become humble in front of the truth. See, this obviously is happening with someone who's doing this to a high level, but it can happen with us as well, doing it in a small level. For example, you've done something wrong, or you know there's a political situation in your own house, or it could be in your own job, or it could be in your own social sort of friends, and you said something which you shouldn't have said. you did something which you shouldn't have done. And then arises a situation that you're supposed to, now you're aware of your guilt. You know deep inside that I shouldn't have said that. I'm the one that started that. I'm the one that created all of this. My action really led to all of this. And you realize that it's you who's the problem. And others around you are now beginning to point at you, and now they're convinced that you're the one. You need to bow your head down to the truth and say, guys, it's my fault. Now at that time, if you do say that, you know, it's my fault, then you are a mutawadhi. You are a person who is humble, and you've proven that. And it's not easy to do that, especially when the greater the matter, the greater the matter, the more difficult it is for people to give in to the truth, because the greater the embarrassment. You know, like, I just, one thing that comes to my mind right now is the whole controversy of the News of the World. You know, News of the World, the whole controversy, yeah, stretching over one whole year now in the media with the courts. If you actually think about it, the amount of people that are lying, and these are big officials, you know, these are MPs involved, you know, police officers. We're talking about chief, you know, superintendent police. You're talking about media giants that are involved, people who are shaking hands and sitting and standing with the MPs and the prime minister, in fact, right? People from his cabinet, right? And you think, because the thing is, the embarrassment that they will get will be a lifetime embarrassment. They'll never be able to come back up from it. But you're in a position already that you have had a lot of responsibility in that position. And you've got to be careful now. They were doing this for years. Imagine 6 years they've been tapping into people's phones, finding out where they're going, making money because they are making media news, sending the paparazzi around to them, and they're surprised. How did the paparazzi know that I'm here? And they've been tapping on their phones, you know, getting their messages, their voicemails, finding out what kind of meetings they've got, okay? And they've been doing this for 6 years to the extent that it is quite clear that inside, people inside who have given out, you know, they brought out the inside story that this is happening. It's a big, big embarrassment. And for them now to carry on sort of putting things under the carpet, and now the people, you know, the force is now moving the rug and seeing what's underneath it. And now Miss Brooks and others who are having to give, you know, they're giving the testimony, and now they're tracking back things. That, how come, hang on a minute, you said this here, you said that there. And it's, you know, they're still having to, once you start lying, see, the problem is, once you lie in the beginning, you have to lie again to hide that lie. But when you made the second lie, you have to make a third and a fourth lie to protect the first and the second lie. And when you carry on doing that, the more lies you make, the more rope you tie around your own neck, or you give to others to tie around your neck, because you're going to get caught one day. See, if it was a simple one lie, then you've got less chance of being caught. But if your lie extends to 10 lies, 20 lies, and further lies to cover the original lie, then you're really having to dig yourself a sand pit and say, goodbye, guys. I mean, I'm drowning in here. So what I'm saying is that when you're in your own situation, we come across these things that Allah tests you. And He tests to see what you're going to do now. If you carry on starting to become this arrogant type of person and say, no, I don't care, so what, I did it, and that's deep inside, whether you admit that to people or not, you know, the worst of people, what they'll do is, you know, they'll keep it all within themselves. And some people, what they'll do is they will admit it to someone, even a close friend, they'll admit it. But some others will eventually come out with it. But the one who's the best one is that he'll put his hands up and he'll say, you know what, it's my fault, I'm in the wrong. And Allah will praise that person for that. Allah will appreciate that person for what they've done. If they can put their hands down and say, you know, I am a person who's done the wrong, Allah loves that. But if the person becomes argumentative, arrogant, even going to tyranny, which is that now they're going to say, okay, you want to catch me? You think I did something wrong? You think that? Okay, I'll show you. I'll prove it to you. So then now what they do is they start to make life difficult for the people who are trying to catch them. That is a real Jabbar. That is Jabbar. A person who's tried to catch, you know, make life difficult for them. I mean, what wrong did they do? They're trying to just find the truth. And you're a person who's become arrogant, not admitting to the truth, and now you're playing games with them and making their life difficult. These are the types of people Allah will call on their heads and say, where are they? Where are they? Come in front of me now and I will take you to task. So you've got that. Now they say that Walid bin Yazid ibn Abdul Malik, who's one of the kings in the past, he took the Quran one day. He was a tyrant king. And he took the Quran one day and he said, okay, let me look in the Quran. And let me see what Allah would have, you know, thinks of me. So this is known as tafa'ul bil kitab. You know, you take the Quran and you say, look, let me just open the Quran anyway. And wherever my eyes fall onto whatever ayah, I can take it as a sign from God that is telling me something. Now, this is obviously not something which is in the Sunnah, but you know, people now and again, when they want to do that, and in this case, it's a tyrant who's doing it, but normally when a person is desperate and they do that, it's up to them. If they find some meaning and they go with it, that's up to them for the whatever meaning they take, but it's not in the Sunnah, it's not in the Quran to do this. So Walid bin Yazid bin Abd Malik did that. And he took it and in his hand, and he looked at an ayah in the Quran, and it was in Surah Ibrahim, verse number 15, Surah number 14, verse number 15, which says, "Wastaftahu wa khaba kullu jabbarin anid." Allah is saying that, you know, my people who are the believers, they sought help from me. And every tyrant who was stubborn on the ground, they perished and they came to an end and they lost. When my believers called on me, made dua to me, and I came to their rescue, then I crushed every tyrant and every stubborn one on the earth. When he read this, he said a poem. He said, this Walid bin Yazid ibn Abdul Malik. What he did is he said a poem. He said, "Atawa'ada kullu jabbarin anid, ha ana dhaak jabbarun anid." Na'udhu billah. He said, what? Every tyrant, every stubborn one, well, here I am. I am the tyrant. I am the stubborn one. Idha ma jitu rabbak yawma hashr. Na'udhu billah. He said this. He said that, when I come to your Lord on the day of resurrection, فَقُلْ يَا رَبِّي مَزَّقَنِ الْوَلِيدِ, then you go and tell your Lord that Walid, he ripped your Lord apart. Now, this is a tyrant on the ground who's saying this about Allah Azza wa Jal. And they say that within days he was killed. He was assassinated. And then, you know, by his own people, he was assassinated. And then they hung him. Within his palace they hung him, and his whole people saw his body, dead body, hung on the on a place of his palace that the people or his crowds could actually see him. And subhanAllah, when Allah wants to crush someone, he will crush someone. See, when they built the Titanic, I don't know if you know this, but when they built the Titanic and they're going to sail from Liverpool to New York, and they're making this journey, one of the ones who made the Titanic said, you know, was asked in an interview just before they left Liverpool. He was asked, you know, do you think this whole ship can actually sink in the ocean? And you know what he said? This Jabbar, this tyrant said, he said that even if God wanted to sink it, he couldn't sink it. This is in their record. This is in their media. This is in, you dig it up, you'll find it. 1915 was the year. It was in 1912, sorry, 1912 was the year. He said, even if God wanted to sink it, he wouldn't be able to sink it. So they went. They went on this cruise liner, this ship, and they sailed across, and they got somewhere near to the, you know, on the Pacific side. And, you know, it was night time. They're all having a wonderful time on the ship. And they're all sort of, you know, these are the wealthiest people who can afford this. Can you imagine? They're the wealthiest people who can afford this. And the luxuries on this Titanic, there is nothing like this in the world. And they move in the night time. When the, and Allah will make them do this. See, Allah will make them do this. If you wanna challenge the Jabbar, the real Al-Jabbar, you wanna challenge him, then he will show you, he'll break you. So they challenged him. So Allah said, okay, you wanna do that? I've got your hearts in my hand. I will make you do things that you will think later, what did I do there? I will make you do it. So what happened is this nighttime. It's, you know, ahead is a bit of mist, right? Ahead is mist. And they all know that in this freezing weather, there can be icebergs that are, you know, very, they're like mountains in the, on the, from the seabed that rise up. They know this. But Allah's got their hearts in His hand. So He makes the sailor of this ship say, nah, don't worry. Ah, you guys have a nice time. Don't worry. Yeah? Don't worry. Titanic! What's an iceberg gonna do to Titanic? An iceberg. We'll break. I mean, he's thinking what? He's thinking, if I go ahead, I'll go slowly, but if I just go ahead and if I hit an iceberg, this thing's so big, it's gonna break the tip of the iceberg. That's what went in his head. Allah made him believe that. He said, yes. He's playing with the Jabbar. They're all playing with Al-Jabbar. So they went ahead. In the night time, and it came across and it hit. And you know, before he went ahead, some of his other sailors said to him, you know, it's not safe. I read about this. I read a whole article about this. They said to him, it's not safe. And he said, don't worry. What can happen? Don't worry. Right? So he went ahead, and it was a very sharp iceberg that they hit. And that you want to play with Allah, okay? You play with Allah now. And that iceberg, not they hit it and they don't realize what they did, is that it actually acts as a knife of Allah. Allah says, okay, you wanna challenge me? Okay, here, slit. I will slice the bottom of your Titanic. So Allah sliced it. They sliced into it. And then after a little while, you know, it's like they're still playing their music and they're enjoying themselves and some are asleep and whatever, the chefs are cooking. And then next minute they know, the sailor says, we're going down. We're going down. You know what? You know, if you look at what happened to the Titanic, subhanAllah, you know when Allah wants to show someone His power. See, the Titanic, imagine I've got one end of the Titanic, so it's like a large sort of boat shape here, okay? What happened is that they built this Titanic so strong that they believed that it couldn't snap. One of the theories was this it can't snap. And they believed that it couldn't be, you know, you couldn't take it down the ocean. So when Allah He sliced this side of the Titanic and the water started to come inside here, okay? What's happening now is that it's getting heavy here. Heavier and heavier. And this part of the boat, the other side of the boat, is now lifting. So Allah wanted to show them who is Al-Jabbar, right? So this is now in the water, that's above the water, and it got so high that in the middle it snapped. Allah snapped it, broke it in half. And then He allowed the two pieces to fall down. But then what does Al-Jabbar do? He allows people in that freezing cold weather. See, he could have snapped this in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. But who would have lived to tell the story? Tell me, who would have lived to tell the story? No one. No one. When Allah gets a tyrant on the earth, He's going to make sure that people are around to talk about the story. when he took Qarun down, so Qarun was another Jabbar. Qarun was another Jabbar, a tyrant, a mighty one, thought that he had it all in his hands. And so, you know, I'll get down to that. But when he snaps someone in half, he will make sure that people are there to tell the story. And subhanAllah, Allah made them, you know, he made this snap near enough for them to get rescue and for many people to live. You know, many drowned, but there were others who lived, and they lived with a face of fear and humbleness to tell the story of what Allah did to them. They lived to tell that story. They had 24 lifeboats on that thing, and it was too less. It was too less for them. But Allah allowed them with their lifeboats to get back to the shore. And those people, till today, they told a story over one century. All the people who lived, they told stories to their children, and their children told that story to their children. And Allah showed them who Al-Jabbar is, who the real mighty one is. And subhanAllah al-Azim, you know, after, and then what does Allah do? Allah makes them go back, and He makes them discover it. They've gone back down there, they've discovered it, and they've seen the ruins and the remains. What is it? Where is that guy who made that statement now, that even if God wanted to sink this ship, he couldn't even sink it? Where is that guy now? So now they've got remains, you know, the fish have just eaten the mold that's growing off on the ship on the bottom of the seabed. That's what Allah's made of it. And this is Allah saying to all the rest of mankind, don't challenge me. Don't challenge me. See, one of the things they say, Allahu Alam, I don't know about this one, but they say that, you know, in 1986, when seven astronauts, they died in a NASA spaceship that took off, it was called the Challenger. It was called the Challenger. Why did they call it the Challenger? Who were they challenging? They were challenging God. That's what, Allahu Alam, if this is true or not, who they were challenging, but the story goes that they were challenging God. Why? Because they wanted to do something, subhanAllah, you know, Allah forbade zina on the earth. He forbade zina, adultery on the earth. They wanted to do adultery in the sky. Amongst those spacemen, there was a woman, space woman. And they wanted to take her up, and they wanted a spaceman to commit adultery with her in space. You imagine, people with money, with power, with might, whatever, what they get to. So Allah thought, well, you want to challenge me? If this is true, you want to challenge me? Then okay, lift off. Come, I'll show you. Lift off. So they lift off. Within seconds, boom, a fire caught at the bottom of the engine, and that was it. Who are you challenging? How can you challenge Allah Azza wa Jal? That Qarun is another great example in the Quran. You know, he came, you know, he was a real tyrant, a mutakabbir, one who had his arrogance, and he was a person who wanted to show off his might. Now, Allah, you know what Allah does is, many of these Jabbars and these other tyrants and mutakabbin, Allah will take them out on their best day. They think that they've reached the height, that it cannot get any better than this. The people are giving them admiration. It cannot get better than this. Allah will take them to that day, to that time, to that moment when all is the best for them. And their heart is, you know, they're thrilled with the enjoyment they're getting, the reception of people's, you know, waves to them. And, you know, yeah. You know, you're the one. Yeah. I wish I was like you. And they're going, that's me. You know, the guy's filled with it. Allah will take him on that day, and then he's going to crush him. So what did Allah do with Qarun? Qarun used to be one who used to show off. You know, his keys. You know, your keys, you can keep your keys in a big treasure place. You know, you can secure them in a big safe. Qarun had the might to make a massive safe and to lock his keys. But Qarun didn't want to do that. Qarun was Jabbar, you know, he wanted to show his might and his power and flex his muscles. So what he did is, wherever he went, there were 10 strong men with, you know, you're talking about built men that could carry and lift. 10 of them followed him, just carrying his keys. The amount of keys he had a lot of treasures. A lot of treasures. And 10 men, can you imagine the amount of keys they're carrying? They're finding it heavy to carry these keys. And their job was just to carry these keys. You know, ding, 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 ding. Imagine 10 of them following him wherever he's going, all right? And they've got all these keys all around them. And, you know, they're carrying them. And they, Allah said, لَتَنُوءُ بِالْعُصْبَةِ الْقُوَّةِ. Allah said that even these 10 men, they're finding it difficult to carry these keys. That's how many treasures Allah gave him, but he wanted to show them off. So what happens is that, you know, he's a big show off. Whenever he comes out, he never wears the same clothes again, right? And these are the most expensive clothes you can get. And so what he did one, and he had so many horses, he had so many of his own soldiers, so many bodyguards, so many palaces, so many treasures. You know, it's unthinkable how much Allah had given him. So what happened is, there was a day, you know, like we have, you know, in this country you don't feel the Eid. You know, Eid, you don't feel it. In our countries you feel Eid. You know, in our own countries. Have you been in our own countries for Eid? Yes? When the whole country is celebrating Eid, yeah? You can feel it. Because everywhere you go, there's everyone smiling and everyone's coming out. And especially when you go to the center of the city. The center of the city, when they're going to have their Eid, then, you know, there's a lot of, everyone's wearing new clothes, everyone's smiling, everyone's giving, you know, something out, everyone's received gifts, everyone's got a nice pair of shoes, everyone's happy on that day, and there's a lot of people, right? We're talking about thousands and thousands of people, especially when you go to the big mosque in the city. So this is known as Yawm al-Zina. This is the day of decoration, which, you know, all countries have, right? So what did Qarun do? Qarun said he's going to come out. He was going to come out on the day of his Eid, in his time, whatever that was, okay? He's going to come out on that day when all people are out in their nicest clothes. He's going to come out with his nicest clothes. So he came out, you know, when they brought him his clothes, he said, not this one, not this one, not this one, not this one. You know, he spent a long time, even he had people choosing for him his best clothes. So he chose his best clothing. Then he said, out of all his horses, he had hundreds of horses. So he went through his horses and said, that one there, the one that is the whitest horse, that people, when they look at it, they're going to say, wow. Yeah, they decorated that horse. They decorated him. So he got onto his horse. And then he said, you know, my soldiers, he wants the best of his soldiers. And they're going to march right behind him. Now there are those 10 men somewhere with all the keys, all right? And he said, you know what? He said, bring all my treasures out as well. Today, you know, I want to show them what I've got. So all my gold, my silver, my merchandise, my, you know, things I've collected, I want you to bring them out, my soldiers to carry them, and they're going to be in there in a way that all people, when I pass by them, they're going to look gobsmacking at the amount of treasures I've got. So now, this is not normal for a person to do. Who's controlling his heart? Come on, guys. Allah is controlling his heart. He's going to bring out his treasures. Which tyrant ever does that? Which tyrant ever does that? But he's going to bring out all his treasures out. So you can see, my God, the pearls and the rubies and the diamonds and the amount of gold and the different shapes. And you know, what happened? When he came out in a parade, he said, I'm going to parade down the whole city. And when he paraded, the people looked at him. And the people of this world, يُرِيدُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. The people who wanted this world, they liked to have this world, they said, they looked at all of this and they said, Ya layta lana mithla ma utiya Qarun. If only we had been given what Qarun has been given. They wished for that. So Allah made them wish for it. So Allah brought all the people. Now imagine, the whole city is here. The whole city is here. And all types of people. You've got the yuridun al hayat al dunya, the people who want to gain this earth. And you've also got those people who are the people of knowledge, right? They said no. They said what? You know, the وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ وَيْلَكُمْ They said, no, what are you doing? Woe to you. Don't ask for this. Whatever Allah has given, it is enough. Whatever Allah has given is enough. Don't wish for whatever they knew that he was a mutakabbir, he was an arrogant tyrant who thought that he was it. And he used to play with people, whatever games he wanted, because he had power, he had might. And the great Fir'aun, he was his friend. Fir'aun was his friend. You know, the pharaohs, they were friends. You know, basically, if anyone touched him, he gonna tell his mate Fir'aun, and you forget it, your history, mate. He'll make you a slave if he has to. So no one messed with Qarun. This was the ultimate tyrant that Allah took out as an example of Quran. So what happened is that when he came out with all of this, and people were looking in amazement of how much he's got. People were on one side, and other people on another side, and right in between is his parade. And when he got to his highest, and he thought, wow, this is who I am. فَخَسَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِ. Suddenly, Allah Azza wa Jal told the earth, my earth, swallow him in right now. Swallow him in front of all these people. So the earth suddenly swallowed him, all his soldiers, all his keys, all his treasures, and even his palace behind. Allah swallowed that in the earth. All of it swallowed, all of it. And the people were left there, right? Some people had run away, but then they thought, well, no, hang on a minute. It's just swallowed him. Just his soldiers. Just his palace. And then the earth came back together. As if nothing happened. And they were absolutely gobsmacked. And Allah showed them, the people and Qarun, who Al-Jabbar is, who are the mighty one is. And this is Al-Jabbar. No one messes with Allah. You know, if you think these kings, the kings in our time, or the presidents or the corrupted ones in our time, if you think they're doing bad, they're doing nothing. They're doing nothing compared to Fir'aun. You know the examples in the Quran? If you ever take the examples of the Quran and you compare them with anyone else ever after until the Day of Judgment, no one would have got to what they've got to. And you talk about Ad. When Allah said, وَإِذَا بَطَشْتُمْ بَطَشْتُمْ جَبَّارِينَ. When you, O people of Ad, Sayyidina Hud said, you people of Ad, you are going mighty on the earth, traversing the earth and causing corruption and killing others. You know how big they were? How big they were? Allah gave them such power from birth that when they grew up, they became so tough that they looked at the mountain. And imagine, they looked at the mountain and said, yeah, that mountain, that looks like a nice house for me. So they started to carved out their house inside the mountain. And they lived in mountains. And they got to other, they were so big, they used to make certain sculptures and certain idols, and they used to put them on certain hills and certain mountains. And this is these people who Allah gave this power to. Do you think anyone else is going to get this power ever till the Day of Judgment? Anyone's going to become giants like them? You know, a large tree that we've got here, they used to pluck that tree out of the ground like you would pluck out a weed out of the ground. You know the way your weed grows, and you basically just take the weed with your hand and you pluck the whole thing out? They take a large tree off our ground and they're able to pluck that out of the ground. That's how much power. And then they got to the height when they thought, all other people in the rest of the world, they're midgets. They're midgets. They're little ants for us. If you want to go and just step on them, we can kill them. We can kill them by stepping on them. So they said, they came, when they made their statement, they said, Man ashaddu minna quwwa? Who has more power than us? Who's got more power than us? Who can have more power than us? We are the most powerful. So Sayyidina Hud said, don't you see that Allah, the one who gave you this power, must have more power than you? Can you make that logic? So how did Allah take those Jabbarin down? They were Jabbarin. The people who wanted to challenge Allah Azza wa Jal. Imagine how big they were, right? They were giants. How did Allah take them down? SubhanAllah, you read the Quran, you'll find out. in Surah Al-Haqqa, Surah Al-Hamim Sajda, Allah sent a wind. Okay. Now when this wind came, today there was a bit of a storm. Did you see that? You see that storm about 1, 2 something, yeah, 2 p.m. something. It was quite rough. All of a sudden it came and you can see things blowing away. Now Allah can do that. Within seconds He can send the wind. So He decided to send them a wind within a moment. Now this wind is coming towards them, but it's so strong. It's blowing so strong. When the wind hit them, these Jabbarin, when the wind hit them, it was so forceful. Imagine it did this to them. That the wind lifted the giants from the ground into the air. That's how forceful the wind was. It lifted them up, but it was so strong that when they came back down with the force of the wind and they hit the ground, they hit it so hard that their arms from the joints and their legs from the joints and the heads from the joint of the body just cracked, smashed, ripped open, and an arm of a giant was found over there, another arm found over there, a leg found over there, another leg over there, his head's over there, and his body's over here. Allah says, and it wasn't just like up and smashed, no. Allah took them up, then He twisted them in the wind, right? This must be some kind of tornado, and it twisted them in the wind, and then He brought them down, crashing down, smack, and then their limbs were basically left separated on the ground. Allah says, "Ajaz nakhlin hawiya." Allah says what? He says, the way if I took a date palm from the ground, and if I was to lift it up with the tornado and twist the tree, and break it and crush it on the ground, the way that would have happened with his branches split over a whole ground, in pieces, that's how I left their limbs on the ground. But then Allah didn't stop there. See, one wind, one great tornado, within minutes Allah could have done this. No, He didn't. He let that tornado carry on spinning in their place for 7 nights and 8 days. 7 nights and 8 days. Now, what does a tornado do to it? There's never been such a long one in the history of mankind. Have you ever heard of a tornado that's lasted for a whole week in one place and is carrying, ripping, tearing pieces and moving? You've never heard of that. This is history in the Quran. So Allah Azza wa Jal, why did He do that? Because what I believe is that the tornado, after killing them, would have taken this dust and the sand and their houses and trees or whatever and carried on mincing them in pieces till it got to dust, and then Allah settled it all over them, which means what? Which means that they're buried deep inside the ground. And there is going to be a day, my friends, when Allah will get some archaeologists that will come back and they will discover these bones. There's going to be a day when Allah will show their limbs that have been scattered. There will be a day. But this is what Allah Azza wa Jal did with those Jabbars. So coming back to the meaning of Al-Jabbar, Imam Qurtubi says, and he quotes on Ibn al-Ambari, he says that Jabbar can have many different meanings. One meaning of the Al-Jabbar is Al-Qahhar, the one who will coerce others, force others. He will force others, show his might over others to make them do something. That's one meaning of Al-Jabbar. Number two, the second meaning of Al-Jabbar is Al-Musallit, which means that he can come as a force controlling them. He can control them, Al-Musallit. One who has got such overbearing power that they cannot organize themselves to control themselves, but this controller controls them. That's one meaning of Al-Jabbar. And that meaning of controlling others, if you want to find that meaning in the Quran, you look in Surah Qaf, the Surah number 50, ayah number 45. Allah has said, وَمَا أَنْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِجَبَّارٍ O Muhammad, I haven't sent you to the earth to become a controller over these people. You don't have, your mission is not to control these people. You've been sent to Makkah and to the world to tell them about Islam and tell them about the message of Islam. But you're not a person who I have sent to control them. What does that mean? That means that you do your job. You just deliver your message. You get them to understand the message. That's fine. Leave them to accept the message. Accept the message, they have to accept it. You can't force them to accept it. You can't control them, and your job is not to do that. Not that Rasulullah was doing that, but he really, really had a heavy heart that these people weren't accepting the message, and that's why Allah has to say that to him. So that's a second meaning of Al-Jabbar. A third meaning is Al-Qawiyyul Azeemul Jism, that someone or a being who is great and great in its size. Great in its size. So, for example, if something is a giant, then you know, you can call them Jabbar. If you want to find this meaning, Ibn al-Lambari says that you look in Surah Ma'idah, the fifth surah, ayah number 22. Inna fiha qawman jabbarin. When Allah sent Musa alayhi salam and his people to go and to take over Palestine and the Holy Land, they came there and they looked and they saw these amalika, they saw these giants that were inside Palestine. So they said, na'udhu billahi min zalik, they said to Musa, he said, you go and tell your Lord to go and fight inside there because there's some giants in there, we can't fight them. Now Allah simply said to them that you walk in that city and they will walk out. I will put fear into their hearts. I will put fear into the hearts of the giants. Allah can do that, yes or no? Yes, he can do that. Just like, you know, sometimes you're a giant, and a spider, small spider, appears, and you go, ah! Have you not seen that? Some people, they see a small spider, the size of which they are a giant to the spider. But they're scared. They're scared. You think, what? They're scared of a spider. How is that? That is Allah. He does that. He can cast fear into you for a small thing. For example, how do you, if you think about Allah's Qudra, how do you as a small man ride an elephant? There are people across the world that ride elephants, yes or no? Yeah. Yes, you've seen that. I saw with my own eyes a man riding an elephant, and he orders the elephant to get down. The elephant gets down, he jumps on the tusk, then he jumps on the head, then he jumps on the body, and then he orders it to get up, and he gets up and he rides the elephant. What made this elephant fear this man? Because if the elephant just lifted his foot up, the man would have run, you know, already a mile before he can fully put his foot down, you know. He's got that power, but who puts that fear? Allah. So he told people of Musa, he said, you guys just walk in there. When they'll see you, they'll fear you, they're going to run. But they didn't. They said, you know, they did, and that's how they lost. And Allah said, you know, now you go to the desert and stay for 40 years. It's a long story, I'm not going to get into that. But the part of that is in Surah Ma'idah, ayah number 22. This is meaning number 3. Meaning number 4 is, of Al-Jabbar is, Al-Mutakabbir an ibadatillah. The one who is too arrogant to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. That is also another meaning of Al-Jabbar. And if you want to find that meaning in the Quran, you look in Surah Maryam, Surah number 19, ayah number 32. Surah 19, ayah number 32. And the verse says, وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْنِي جَبَّارًا شَقِيًّا. Sayyiduna Isa ibn Maryam, Sayyiduna Isa, the son of Maryam, alayhi salam, he said that I've been born and I've got these qualities, and Allah has not made me one who is too... There, Jabbaran means what? I'm not too arrogant to become a servant of God. There are certain people you meet, subhanAllah, they're too arrogant to bow down. You know, I don't know if you've ever looked into the story. I read the whole autobiography of Malcolm X. It's a really good book if you want to read it, by I think it's by Huxley. So if you get to read the autobiography of Malcolm X, it's a wonderful book, wonderful piece. Very good English in there as well. One of the fascinating things I found about him was that he was, and this is clearly, you know, representing people like that. He lost faith in God. He lost faith, and he became a person who was imprisoned. And in the prison, he was so fed up of his life and what God, what he believed, that if there ever was a God, he used to swear at that God. This is before he became Muslim. He used to swear at that God. He used to, you know, when they ever, in the prison inmates, if they ever brought the subject of God, he used to be the most foul-mouthed person about God. That effing this and whatever, you know, he would come out of his mouth. To the extent that he earned himself the name of Satan. The other inmates would refer to Malcolm X as Satan because of his attitude towards God. And then somebody came inside the prison and gave him dawah. And he accepted the dawah, so he became a Muslim. But he said the most difficult thing for him now was to do what we do so easily. Now you've got to understand this. You know what we're doing every salah, subhanAllah. If you read this passage in Malcolm X's book, it really makes you think, what are we doing every single salah? Because in salah, you are, I want you to first understand what Malcolm X is saying. Malcolm X is saying that I had to kneel and bow down to this deity. So he said that was the most difficult thing for me to do. The most difficult thing. He said I bent my knees slowly. Can you imagine? I bent my knees slowly and I put them onto the ground. Now he's still thinking, what is he doing? He's in his cell in the prison. And he wants to do sujood to Allah, but it's not easy. It's not easy. So he's bending his back slowly and he's thinking, how am I going to put my nose and my forehead on the ground? Okay, I'll go as far as this. Alright? I'll go as far as this. But then it took him a lot to break himself inside and to say, you know, nah, come on, I've got to do this. And he puts his nose and his forehead onto the ground. You know what that is? That shows that a man has no pride left. That I'm nothing compared to you. And I've given myself 100% into you. You are everything, I'm nothing. I want us to realize, you know, when we go to sujood, it's a big thing. It's not a small thing. It's telling Allah that Allah, you're everything. I've given myself into you. My hands, my feet, my body, my you know, knees on the ground, my head is on the ground, my nose on the ground, my brain's next to the ground. You know, you are everything. You've got my forelock in your hand. This is a big statement we're making by the sujood. So, you know, this ayah, lam yajan jabbar shaqi, there are people on the across the globe. They can't do it. They can't become a servant of God. You know, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time, once he read an ayah in front of the Kaaba, and he read it with such beauty and the meaning was so beautiful, and you know, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went into sujood, and the people, the kuffar around him, they went into sujood, right? But there was one guy who was mesmerized by the Prophet's recitation and about the whole verses, but he was too arrogant to go into sujood. So he picked up a rock from the ground and he put it to his head. That was his sujood. That was his sujood. He's too arrogant. There are people like that. They're too arrogant to make the ibadah or go into the worship of Allah. So this part you will find there. So this was a fourth meaning of Jabbar. A fifth meaning is which what I already said about the people of Aad, that they would go around killing. Batashtum batashtum jabbarin. This is in Surah Shu'ara 26 and ayah number 130. Right? So they basically, this is that meaning. And also you will find in Surah Qasas, Surah number 28, ayah number 19. In turidu illa an takuna jabbaran fil ard. You know, this statement was made to Musa alayhi salam, and the person who made it was a non-Muslim, but he said, when Musa killed that Coptic, and the next day he came and found another argument, that soldier who was a non-Muslim said to Musa, he said, all you want to do is you just want to kill on the earth. You're going to kill this. Not the soldier, the person who he came to aid to, and you know there was some confusion over the matter. Not that Musa wanted to do that, but he was accused of this. But the meaning there, Jabbaran fil ard, is qattalan, which means you want to kill. So one of the meanings of Jabbar is to kill. And a sixth meaning of Jabbar is At-tawil min al-nakhli. If you have a tree or something that becomes really tall, really big in size, it can be referred to as Al-Jabbar. And Imam Qurtubi has narrated poems from Imru'ul Qais and others. And the meanings of this all comes to one, which is that sometimes you can get a grape that can become really big in size. In the Arabs would refer to it as Jabbar, meaning that it's an overgrown size, it's really big. So anything big can have the meaning of Jabbar. Imam Khattabi, he says that Allah Azza wa Jal, when He is Jabbar, it means that He can do with His creation something of His, either of His command or Him preventing them, He can do something with them. As a sultan, as a king, as one who is in might and power, as one who rules over them, he can do that, and he can compel them. He can compel someone to do something. That is the meaning of Jabbar. Also, because Allah is the one that the poverty and the needs and the necessities of His creation, because Allah fulfills them. Allah amends their poverty, their situation of poverty. He amends and alleviates them. He puts them back together again. He provides them, sustains them in a way that they wouldn't do without Him. That is now also the meaning of Jabbar, which means to actually amend. Something's broken, you put it together. That's what He does with the creation, and therefore He earns His name Al-Jabbar. He has His name Al-Jabbar. Another meaning is that because Allah Azza wa Jal has the right to look down, has the right that He is muta'azzim, He is great, and everything else to Him is nothing, it's small, it's insignificant. So Allah Azza wa Jal has the right to call Himself Al-Jabbar, which means that He is full of greatness. It's not negative at all. He deserves that. He is full of greatness. We're the ones that are so small in front of Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Ibn al-Hisar, he says that if you look in the Quran, you will find that the word Jabbar has fallen right in between Al-Aziz and Al-Mutakabbir. Al-Aziz, the one of might, the one who gives dignity, the one who gives power, and Al-Mutakabbir, the one who has the right to see himself as greater than everything else. That's Al-Mutakabbir. So in between that, in asma-ul-husna, in the hadith, Al-Jabbar has occurred. And in the Quran, in Surah Al-Hashr, the same thing has happened. So what does this mean? This means that the meaning of Al-Jabbar we should give to Allah Azza wa Jal for Him being Jabbar is that He is mighty, He is full of power, and He is omnipotent, which means that He has the power to do anything. That's the meaning we should give Him. And that is why when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he used to go into his ruku and sujood, one of the phrases he used to say, which has been reported in Ahmad, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Tabrani, Bayhaqi, and so on, is Subhana dhil mulki wal malakuti, Subhana dhil izzati wal jabarut. So Subhana dhil mulki wal malakut, Subhana dhil izzati wal jabarut, which means what? That he's in sujood, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in sujood and ruku, and he's saying, you, O Allah, you are exalted and above and free from any blame or anything that is impure that has been attributed to you, the one who possesses the dominion and the one who possesses all things that are owned. You, O Allah, are much high and much exalted and much high, free from any blame, anything impure attributed to you, the one who is possessor of dignity, izzah, and wal jabarut, power, the one who is you know, is possessor of power of might. You are that one. So from this hadith you understand, Ibn Hisar says that from this you understand that Allah Azza wa Jal, you know, Rasulullah, when he said this, the meaning of Al-Jabbar given there, or Jabarut given there, is of might and of power, and that is the meaning of Al-Jabbar, that is mighty, he is powerful. Even though you can say that Al-Jabbar is the one that can actually smash things, he can, if he wants to smash anything on the earth or the creation, you can give that meaning to Al-Jabbar, yes, but it's more appropriate that you give him the meaning of being mighty and being powerful. And this all comes back to one thing, which is that Allah deserves, rightfully so, to have the quality of being almighty, all-powerful, having the greatest of existence and the greatest of might, the greatest of power, in a way that no one besides him has any, you know, right to claim over that. So all others should subdue to his power. Another meaning is, another thing that comes from this meaning is that Allah Azza wa Jal, he is, since he is powerful, he is in no need, this is a beautiful phrase here, يَسْتَغْنِي عَنِ الْأَتْبَاعِ فَلَا يَكْثُرُ بِهِمْ مِنْ قِلَّةِ وَلَا يَسْتَنْصِرُ بِهِمْ مِنْ ذِلَّةِ كَمَا قَالَ تَعَالَى وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ وَلِيٌّ مِنَ الذُّلِّ. Allah Azza wa Jal in Surah Al-Isra, he has said in ayah number 111, he has said he has no one close to him due to him being low. If he makes anyone close to him, he has done a favor unto them. If Jibreel is close to him, it's Allah's favor that Allah's made Jibreel close to him. If Allah makes Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam a close one to him, if Allah said Ibrahim is my Khalil and I consider him to be a metaphoric friend, not a real friend, but one who you could, you know, the way you see a friend, that, you know, I give him that title, fine. But I do not do that because I am one who is low and I need someone. No, I do that as a favor unto them. That's my favor to them. So Ibn al-Arabi says that due to this, you can see the name Al-Jabbar. That Allah Azza wa Jal, yes, He does not need anyone to follow him or follow his commands so that he can become greater because of him having less beforehand. No. He doesn't become great because of you coming to him. وَلَا يَسْتَنْصِرُ بِهِمْ مِنْ ذِلَّةِ. He doesn't, you know, okay, Allah has called the soldiers of Allah on the earth, the people who go and fight for Allah's sake, he has called them Hizbullah. He said, "Ulaika Hizbullah." We're not talking about the Hizbullah in Lebanon, all right? Please, no, I don't want the MI6 to now take me and imprison me because I mentioned this. This is a statement in Surah Mujadala. Allah says, "Anyone who on his behalf is doing things for his religion, Ulaika Hizbullah, they are the party, or they are they're the group who are on behalf of Allah. That's all it means, Hizbullah. They've taken that meaning for themselves, right? I don't like it when people take these things and they put it for themselves, and if they get a bad name, then the Quranic ayah gets a bad name. I don't like that. But anyway, when I mention Hizbullah, I'm talking about anyone on the earth who Allah is using as his soldier on the earth. As his, you know, and his soldiers are not just men, please. His soldiers are the ants. His soldiers are the ants. If he wants to use them, he can use them. His soldiers, amongst his soldiers are the winds. Amongst his soldiers are the mountains. Amongst his soldiers is the earth itself. Amongst his soldiers are even, you could say, a small fly or a mosquito. A mosquito, Namrud, a tyrant, a jabbar on the earth. Namrud, you know, he said, okay, if God exists, then I'm going to fight that God. Here's another Jabbar, a tyrant. So here comes Namrud, the Jabbar, and he says, okay, my army, he had a massive army. He said, okay, army, come together. We're going to take our arrows and we're going to shoot them straight in that sky from where the revelation comes to Ibrahim. And he got his whole army out. And he said, come on! You call yourself Allah, God? You think you're there? Well, if you're there, I challenge you. So this Jabbar challenged Al-Jabbar. The real Al-Jabbar. So he shot. And he shot. And he said, come on, come, come. Come and fight me. Where are you? So Allah Azza wa Jal said, okay. You want to fight? Let's fight. Let's fight. Allah sent down mosquitoes. Mosquitoes. You know, when a mosquito bites you, what are you going to do? You can just go like that. That's it. Allah said, okay, so I'll send you a weak army of man. Go fight me. Go fight me. So he sent mosquitoes that. When these mosquitoes came, what's all this? Hey. There's so many, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them all over the place. The soldiers were running everywhere. They were running. All right? They're running. And Namrud, you know, he's also running. But what happens is, you know, this is what does well. A mosquito's here, right? And he goes, he sniffs. And the mosquito goes into his nostril. And Allah makes that mosquito survive. So that mosquito is now alive and is somewhere there. Inside his head and onto his brain, somewhere by his brain, right? And it's alive. So now what happens is, this Namrud, who's a tyrant on the earth, who wanted to challenge Allah, he's got a living mosquito inside him, and that mosquito is sucking blood. Every time he sucks blood, right? Every time he sucks blood, he whacks his head. He whacks his own head. And when he whacks his head, then the mosquito stops, and he gets a bit of relief. When the mosquito gets hungry again, he sucks blood, he whacks his head. Then now he's getting tired of whacking himself. So he told his soldier, when the soldier, he said, hey, listen, stand next to me with this club. Every time I tell you. This is in the Israeli riwayat. This is in the Israeli riwayat. Now, you know, you can take benefit from it. So every time he gets this really bad. And you know what does a mosquito do? Somebody's not sucking blood. Something, you know, if you have a mosquito and you're trying to sleep, what's the sound of a mosquito? Right? This thing's in his head. So it's going, and he's going, and he's going mad. So he's telling this guy, no, hit me. So he hits him. That's good. Then he rests for a little while. Then he says again, when the mosquito bites, he says, hit me. So he hits him. This soldier is standing there. He's hitting now the king. He's hitting Namrud. That Namrud challenged Allah. So he's hitting that Namrud. Now he's hitting him. Now this soldier, now days are going by, and this king is going mad. He's going insane. This buzzing sound, the sucking of his blood, you know. And what it's one small soldier of Allah. One small soldier of Allah. One mosquito. You say, you want to challenge me? Go on, I challenge you. You want to fight? Let's fight. I'll send you one of my soldiers. I'll see if you can take him on. If you can take him on, then perhaps you can move on to take some other soldiers of mine, because you're not getting to me yet. So this soldier got so sick. You know, the soldier's holding this club, and he has to hit him. And he's saying, yeah, it's tiring to do that, right? And each time he hits him, the buzzing doesn't stop until he hits him a bit harder. So now the wax are getting harder. Now this guy is taking a lot of blows on his head, right, because of this mosquito. In the end, the soldier thinks, you know, that's enough, man. Let me just give him one. Let me try and kill the mosquito. So he whacks this king, and by hitting him so hard, this guy collapsed on the ground, and that Jabbar is dead on the ground. Allah killed him. That Jabbar is dead on the ground. You can now imagine, subhanAllah al-Azim, Allah Azza wa Jal does not need anyone, you know, for any reason for him to, you know, the hadith is quoted here by Imam Qurtubi, that even if the whole of mankind, this is one beautiful hadith, that we shouldn't feel in any way that we are doing a service for God, No. The service, this, you know, you might be doing the ibadah of Allah, and you might get happy that, you know, I've served Allah. Now you shouldn't even have that. No. The honor is not your honor. The honor is Allah's honor, that He gave you permission to serve Him. Subhanallah. The honor is Allah's honor that He gave you guidance. The honor is Allah's honor that He never made you a tyrant on the ground. The honor is Allah's honor that He gave iman in your heart. The honor is Allah's honor that He made you come to salah. And the honor is Allah's honor that He made you go down to the earth and not made you jabbaran shaqiyya, one who's too arrogant to do the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. That is why Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, when he used to start his tahajjud, he used to cry over the ayah, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. He used to cry over that. Every night for tahajjud, he used to get up, and when he used to read these verses, he used to cry. Why? What is إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ? What is he saying? It is saying that you only do we worship, and you only do we seek help, from whom we seek help. He used to cry. Why? Because he's thinking to himself that, oh Allah, if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't even get up this night. So who am I to say to you that you only I am serving? Who am I to say that I'm serving you? No, the honor is yours, the dignity is yours, my Lord, for waking me up and giving me the opportunity to serve you. And that used to make him humble and used to make him cry. And Imam Qurtubi says that one of the things that you need to remember is that you make yourself this miskeen in front of Allah. And that's one of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Tirmidhi. Allahumma ahyini miskeena, wallah, make me stay alive as one who needs you, who's in need of you. Wa amitni miskeena, make me, when I die, make me one who dies in need of you. Wa shunni fi zumaratil masakeen, and make me die while I'm amongst the group of people when you resurrect me, make me resurrect on the day of judgment, that I come up amongst the people who need you. I want to be amongst always the people who need you. Not to feel that you know, you're the one who needs. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. Allah does not need anyone. So Rasulullah says another hadith, and Imam Qurtubi reminds us of this, is a hadith and a dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is Allahumma filli khata'i wa amadi wa kullu dhalika indi. Oh Allah, you forgive me for my mistake, whether I've done it out of mistake, whether I've done it purposefully, whatever I have done, forgive me. Wa kullu dhalika indi. But and oh Allah, I admit all of it is from me. You don't make me sin. If I do anything wrong, it's myself. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is only saying this so that he can teach us to say this. Not that he sins. He doesn't sin. But he's only teaching us to say this and to humble ourselves in front of Allah azza wa jal. And there is another long hadith. It's almost time for Maghrib. Where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he shows his entire, and he used to do this in many different ahadith, where he would show his entire desperateness to Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah loves this, where, you know, he would say to him words like, you know, da'ufa quwwati, my power is weak. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, qillata hilati, you know, my plans are inappropriate that I can do anything with them. You know, you're the planner, you're the one who is the powerful one. Ya Arhamar Rahim, and so on. So we're supposed to humble ourselves in front of Allah Azza wa Jal in this manner. And Imam Qurtubi finishes up by saying, it is فَيَجَبُ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ, it is incumbent on every single Muslim, on every single believer, أَلَّا يَتَّصِفَ بِهَذَا الْإِسْمُ وَلَا يَتَعَاطَاهُ, that we do not take this name for ourselves, that we don't call ourselves Jabbar in any way. We find that Allah Azza wa Jal, He deserves to see our tadhallul, our lowliness in front of Him, iftiqar, us showing our need and necessity to the lil malik al wahid al jabbar, so that we show it to the true King, who is the one and only, and who is the mighty one. Alladhi ista'ala ala al mawjudat, who has His power of everything that exists. وَقَهَرَهَا بَعْدَ أَنْ أَنْشَأَهَا, and He has compelled it after He created it. وَخَلَقَهَا وَلَمْ يَزَلْ مُسْتَعْلِيَا, and He created it and He is the one who is still in charge and above all of it. فَالْخَالِقُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَرَبُّ الْعِزَّةِ وَالْجَبَّارِ, He is the one who is the creator, the Rabb and the Lord of dignity and of power and of might. Alladhi yabtishu bil jabbarin, who takes every mighty one on the ground with his grip and he will crush them and bring them down. Wa yuhliku man sha'a kayfa sha'a, and he will destroy whoever he wants, however he wants. Wa ya'khudhu akhdhal aziz al muqtadir, and he will take them in a way that he will show his might and his power over them. Wa la yakhafu al uqba, he does not fear the end of anyone who is in front of him. Wa lahu al akhiratu wal ula, and he has the beginning and the end is all for him, and everyone besides him yastaghith should try and ask Allah azza wa jal to give him the rahmah and his mercy. Jazakumullah khair. Inshallah, we will see you next week for the next session on al-mutakabbir and other names. Jazakumullah.